The only formal training I've always had is with the Dhananjayans, Bharatanatyam. And they were neighbors living a street away. I was 8 years old, and like most children, I was sent to dance class. Dance and music was part of a kind of a education that we were all expected to have, and I went the same way at age 8, and I stayed on more or less till 25, 26, and I still am staying on more or less, although my work has diverged a little bit.
What made you decide to go towards a more contemporary approach of dance?
Not really one decisive thing, but a series of several things, several factors, several incidents, several changing things in the environment, that kind of, and it didn't happen overnight. It sort of happened over years. So this was largely my experience. I think if I have to honestly answer that, it'll take me a little bit of a long explanation, if it's okay with you. The Bharatanatyam that I was taught is fairly coming out of the modernist movement in India. So it's a post-national configuration of what dance is, and part of the Indian identity is also proposed within this. And every time you're anywhere else in the world, or even to Indian communities and audiences, the idea of being a sort of a cultural ambassador is, you know, without it being put into so many words, you were always raised and taught with the notion that you had a certain role to fulfill in upholding a certain ethos and a culture and an unbroken line for several centuries. And this, when I found out, was not entirely true, that it has actually gone through so many cuts and rifts and ruptures and changes and beautiful evolutions because of them also. It made me think about what I'm doing then, you know. More importantly, the formality in the work was something I loved very much. But also as a teenager growing up in this very conservative city, and also being inside a Brahmin Hindu household, and also learning an art form which is filled with the content material that is divine for the most part, forcing you to make public a certain relationship with notions of God or godliness, somewhere did not sit very comfortably in my body or in my mind by the time I was 17, 18. It was a little bit hard for me to convincingly carry out this role as I began to see it. It's also a fairly done thing, this business of, you see, most girls learn dance and go through their formal debut, the Arangetram, and then pursue their higher education,
get married.
And so this dance is sort of a nice finishing school, which the information most people carry through their lives, but not necessarily with the same sort of a passion, or a few of them continue to think of themselves as professional artists. They may be professional doctors, lawyers, and many of my colleagues are whom I'm describing, but they are all really wonderful people and very fine dancers also. But it remains, for me, it has always remained a question, how public do you want to be with this? If so, what's the message that's going out to people? You know, and the situation around me was also beginning to be quite turbulent, with a lot of communal, you know, problems. Being in Chennai also, home birthplace of the Dravidian movement, although the anti-Brahmin movement was a generation before mine possibly, there was still the aftermath of this that I found in people that I was encountering through my own curiosity, writers, theater people, and I stumbled upon two of the most seminal movements in dance and theater in Chennai. One was Chandralekha, and the other was the Kootupattrai. And the third, in fact, was the Cholamandal Artist Village. So all three are very, very seminal sort of movements, where you can say things that influenced a whole generation, things that came to stay as historical shifts in a perspective. And
which year would that be about?
My stumbling upon these things, possibly the 1996, 97, around this time, by which time these were established, points of reference for, I mean, everybody knew about them. And I realized that apart from this large mytho history that I was being raised in about where dance came from, and the information is always there, historical information is available, but it remains up to the student to actually go and seek it out. And I must say that the focus was on the practicalities of dancing so much, not really other things. And I began to feel the need to find another way around.
Did you shift from Bharatanatyam, straight Bharatanatyam, to Chandralekha, or how did you compose?
There was nothing that was a clear shift. I was continuing. I was a very dedicated solo Bharatanatyam dancer. I was also, the Dhananjains don't, I mean, they have a fantastic school, and I was a teacher in the school, and I was also a performer with a group, and it was all, you know, a wonderful sense of community that we had, and that I'm very grateful for to this day. But when these questions were churning inside me and I wasn't even able to express them very much within that environment, I did actually come across Chandralekha largely through my father, who said, hey, there's someone down that road by the beach who talked to me about planets and astrology being part of what she creates as dance. Why don't you go check it out? And I didn't for more than a year or two. But when I eventually did, there was great hostility also from that side, because there was a history of being rejected and insulted. Chandra had this whole thing of not being accepted by the traditional community, and that ire was very strong. And here was I waltzing in saying, can you talk to me? And she was like, go away and read. So it was a good thing, because I realized that I was curious, and so I did get some reading done. Not that I had the reference points enough to locate them in any way that I could understand. So I returned to her and I said, okay, I've read. 1 week later. And I said, I've read. Now, help. I want to see something. She was kind. And she said, look, you can't understand things by clinically looking at them and reading. You need to find something in your body. So she asked me to join the Kalaripayattu class that was just about beginning with Shaji there. And I was one of his first students. And I stuck on for 2 to 3 years doing this. And the experience of just finding a martial energy in the body was a big shift compared to the kind of an aesthetic that was steeped inside the body about what is even beauty, or what is strength, what is grace, what is expression. So these shifts were more of a practical knowledge that began to seep into the body, and the curiosity to find where this could be in a larger cosmos kept returning. And also it was a very kind of a claustrophobic environment in Chennai for me at that time, because the parameters seemed to be getting smaller and smaller inside which any kind of learning could take place, or so I went for a year to the UK, to London, on a scholarship, where I did a master's. My idea was not really to do the master's, but it came to me, and it was a way for me to be away and to really see and learn and watch from a different environment, and therefore re-question my points of reference. It wasn't easy when I went to the Laban Center in London. I went for a year in the year 2000. I realized that I had a lot of reading to do, and I did. That's something that I'm consciously continuing to do even now, to keep pushing my points of reference. But many things happened in that year. One was really trying to see what the value of being this kind of an artist is for myself, what it means to the environment I was in. And while a lot of other people who had come to the UK, like me, from various parts of the world, even from India, a few years before me, were always trying to find a foothold to stay on and to find something there. And towards the end of my year there, it became very clear to me that if I was to remain in the UK, then I would only become one more exotic dancer. That was the only way I could actually find a place to stay on there. You know, I would not be seen for anything other than my brown skin and my mudras and my... this is the feeling that was very strong, and that's something that I was not really interested in, because by this time I had actually met Chandra here, been exposed to a certain way of looking at abstraction, and I had also done a little bit of work with Padmini by then. I stood in for one of her dancers who had wasn't able to make it to a show, and over the period of 3 months of working with Padmini, something of a methodology and an approach and a vision for the Indian body was already planted in my head, and that vision became stronger over the years, slowly.
How long did you work with Padmini? Did you work with her along with your own
To some journey? Degree, yes. We started working in 1999, and till 2011 we've been working together. Those are very, very rich years of my life, and it was very wonderful to be training 5 days of the week through the year with the concept of developing process, making a work over 1 or 2 years on an everyday basis. It's a luxury. When I'm here on my own trying to make work, I realize the value of that very much. And, just the ability to have a bunch of people to submit to that process wholeheartedly and to value every day's findings, that's not something that's been easy to carry on. Not for her, not for me.
Not for her either.
Yeah.
And so in those days, you mean to say that you were able to have this sort of regular practice, which is not the case today?
Yes, I mean...
even for her.
Yeah, even for her. Yeah, it's not possible. I mean, coming back to why... So I came back after this year in the UK knowing that there was a richness to pursue with Padmini, also that many of my own questions about identity or even expression or aesthetics and politics were not entirely answered by the work with her, although I knew that that was a learning period and you need to go down the road long enough. So I did continue to work with her, allowing these things to sort of soak and ask the questions with a little bit more depth, hopefully in time, not really to find answers in a hurry. But around 2003, I started to make some work of my own alongside with Padmini's. And so I did make a series of solo propositions for the longest time alongside working with Padmini. My need for a group was more than satisfied with the work we were doing together. So the questions I had of myself, I realized were at that time largely to do with my own dancerliness, and to find that sort of resolution, the solo presented itself as the most possible thing. And yes, it was possible for us to work as a company with her, because she was receiving co-production support from European theatres, which allowed her to pay us a kind of a stipend in Indian money, which...
Those were the years you came to Teatro de la Vila.
Yeah, it started off with the... It started off earlier than that with the Schaubühne, and with the Grand Theatre Groningen, with a few other big home houses like this, and the Teatro de la Vila was, I think, not until 2010. Yeah, I think. Yeah, Paper Doll was the first piece we took there. Gerard Violette was still director there, and and we took two more pieces there. But
okay,
this was the time that a lot of my own personal questions were also taking shape. What I'm trying to explore is to find to find the body of the Indian dancer once again, to find the body once again. Because one is that we've become a very self-conscious nation, One is that one has to contend with what the state expects dance to do. And if you reject that, then there is the eye of the world outside, which has a certain need for Indian-ness. And whatever it be. And then you find these collaborative kind of propositions in which you need to, yeah, the choices, the aesthetic choices, which then are also political choices, become, they betray your lack of being able to uphold what you were searching for in the first place. I find that's a very important thing to address in the work I do. So I try to find what it is to have a body that's stripped of virtuosity, that is stripped of a certain technique, which is what is hiding the person behind. So I'm interested in people through the dance. So I try to find a way to devise technique which allows people to be visible. And I'm also saying that because it's a reaction to what has happened within the sphere of contemporary dance over the last 10 years or so. You see, more than 10 years ago, the questions were always about tradition and departures from tradition, assuming that the two big dance industries in India are the classical industry and the Bollywood industry. These are the two industries that the world knows, and they're kind of big. And you can always argue about support and all of that, but in terms of a public consciousness, these are the two big points of reference. Parents want children to learn Bharatanatyam, like my parents did also, because they're learning culture. It's the stamp. So, why would anyone send their kid to learn contemporary dance? I mean, essentially, I see it as a something to do strongly with criticality, to be self-reflective, to be a little bit questioning what is status quo in the society you're living in, whether you're responding to questions of gender, whether you're responding to questions of capitalism or politics, or not that it always has to be driven by a form of protest very specifically. Sometimes it is, but by and large, to be able to preserve the body from becoming a cause for something else is already the job, I feel, of contemporary dance. And also to find, you see, it's we've become a nation of clerks trained in various techniques that we've imported. Someone from here is coming to teach this technique, someone from there is coming to teach that technique. I think it's great that you learn a lot of different things, but if you don't know why you're learning it, then you become this melting pot of various techniques that you can carry out. And you become somebody with a good toolkit, but you're no more than a technician with a toolkit. Can you then imagine for yourself what a body must be, or what this body in this country needs to do? Even if you take away the notions of country, the push now is for a global kind of a citizen. No? I mean, there are people living 2 months here, 2 months there, 2 months somewhere else. So the question of having to uphold identity is also perhaps not so important to a lot of people who are in the contemporary field now. But questions of authenticity will always return. Not originality, but authenticity. How do you make something authentic? And a lot of the times techniques are useful, you know, there are a whole lot of somatic techniques that are useful to take on and, you know, kind of train the body in a way that you understand yourself better. But by and large, there is a culture of just having technique replace content. And that is a dangerous trend. And I feel a lot of the work I'm trying to do is to counter that trend. Okay. Well, I think I'm assuming that I am Indian and I don't need to refer to it. Okay. I'm Indian in the way I stand and sit. I'm Indian in the way I talk and eat. And I don't anymore feel the pressure to mark that in my work. If it appears, it appears. For an eye that is not accustomed to seeing someone squat in a certain way, it may appear as Indian. But I'm certainly not going to place things that are... I do work with a lot of other dancers, in fact, but it's a recent trend. So what happened was that once Padmini's work diversified after 2010-11, we were not meeting regularly anymore. We would meet for certain shows, or we would meet on the context of the collective we started together, but we weren't, the culture of everyday work was not possible to maintain, no studio space, no all the rest of it. But one of the first things I did was to respond to a commission to make a piece about Tagore. And I worked with a girl from Mauritius who was a student at the time and started off with a duet. And then I made a solo for a Kathak dancer called Vikram from Calcutta, who asked me to make the solo. Yeah. So I made the solo for him. And the act of actually stepping out and working on another body with a form that I had no clue about already was a step in kind of thinking of choreographic work outside of my body, which was a big shift for me. And subsequently, I went on to do something called the Jumping Project, which was by far a very good thing for all of us to have done, because we were 10 people. I mean, 25 people have been trained for this work, but including Praveen. And people came from all walks of life. I mean, I was involved in Praveen's theatre group, and I was training them for some physical training. And then I asked some of them, I'm trying a new work, will you come? So there were actors, there was a lawyer, there's a fitness expert, a parkour guy, you know, name it. Very, very, people from very different walks of life, but having some kind of an interest in a bodily practice. And when I proposed jumping as a thing to do, it was open enough for them to enter and be.
And jump.
And they were all ages, from 58 to 23. It was a good kind of, the piece is still ongoing. We opened in 2015, November. And we will still be performing it in February 2018. So it's still an ongoing piece for 2 years. Which
do
is
you have some images of this?
I have. I will send it to you. I have a film of it also.
Yeah,
I will
send
to you. So it's a piece that has actually, because of its democratic nature, it has actually been very popular, and a lot of people have actually felt close to it. It's something that seems to find its place in a lot of people's hearts. And so that, of course, it's a struggle to keep it up. Not everybody is from Chennai. There are people from Bombay and Calcutta and initially from Sri Lanka. And so every time we need to do a show together, it's quite a difficult act of bringing everyone together and working. But it's part of all the difficulty that surrounds work in this country, in any case, without exceptions. Yeah. The work you're referring to, Sweet Sorrow, it's
yes.
a piece I made in 2010. It's a solo. This particular piece was very much for an audience that's used to seeing dance in a certain way, and it was kind of playing on the cliches that we associate with watching dance. And so, assuming that everything is about meaning, you kind of, in all traditional concerts where dancers come and explain what they're doing, like Krishna is waiting. So I'm a compare myself, and I've done this ton, so I was taking a pot shot at myself, which is a good way to start always. Since the piece was about sorrow, there was a need to actually bring in the element of the ridiculous, because sorrow comes at you when you least expect it. It doesn't come in a way that you can actually lay it out cleanly page by page. You know, it attacks you when you're least prepared for it. And somewhere the comedy of it, the ridiculousness of it, and the complete unprepared, gut-wrenching moment in the middle of it is all part of what went into the making of that. And the process for me in various stages was, this particular one was distancing the speed of the text and the speed of the gesture, so that you kind of reverse the relationships people make with meaning. You know, gestures are not symbols that are, they have a life beyond what they refer to or what they stand for. The body is more than a medium for meaning. It's a meaning in itself, and it can't be equated to words. For example, the process I'm in right now, I'm in the process of creating a new work, and it's for 4 female dancers in a circular space. And the work is very much about finding the melting body, or the body that's in the process of movement, because these are the bodies that cannot be pinned down to theories of description, theories of identity, citizen, man, woman, girl, poor, homeless, rich. These are things that do not actually... A moving body resists all these descriptions, and this processual body, this you know, when you're about to reach for something, when the body is constantly in the act of change, it kind of has a certain quality of being wax, you know, that you're constantly melting, that it's not something that is fixed. So the process for this has very much been about finding very deep and strong lines in the body and trying to really see how they can melt and mold. Yeah. So, and to think about the body as affecting the space much more than being visible in its own lines. So that's something that we're working on at the moment, and we will open in February. Next. If you want to be involved in the business of making art, I think travel is absolutely necessary. Otherwise, one tends to be kind of blind, and you know, you end up being a little bit self-referential all the time, and that's a danger. So I think exposure, travel, meeting, I think it's an important part of what develops the mind for any creator, whether you're a visual artist or a musician or a dancer or a choreographer or a theatre person. I think it's important. Travel to some degree is important. I feel that one has to be strongly aware of the political standpoints in all these occasions. Now, why would person X from one part of the world come to this part of the world to teach what they have? Of course, you can always argue about the efficiency of the systems of teaching, the time-tested techniques. You can talk about successful artists who've come out of that process, and you can always think of it as an educational tool. But we return to the question of the toolkit and the technician. So you have to be very, very clear. A lot of the time people come here because funding is also organized like this, that if you go to work in Bangladesh or India or Sri Lanka or Pakistan or Afghanistan or Israel or the Gaza Strip, there's certain projects that are available for that sort of thing. Now, not everything is bad because of that.
Yeah.
Not everything is bad. I think sometimes it's possible to find, it's possible by and large, if the product is dependent on these collaborations, I've always found them to be fairly diluted in their vision. But sometimes, rarely, you do find a fairly deep thinking artist who's there simply to make a connection. And that apart, I feel that these countries, okay, as an Indian from this country, I would like to have a choice in what's coming in here. I would like to choose what sort of an artist comes here to perform. I would like to have a say in what sort of workshops are thrust upon us, and not just blindly receive. And that choice is not always available.
I see.
There's a growing interest and curiosity. Also, a lot of changes have happened within the classical field and in what they want to do and propose for themselves. So people are following that. Yes, there's still a huge amount of distrust of anything that doesn't come with the sanction of the classical. And there's a certain inability to value certain things. But I think it's only a matter of time before these journeys are made. And the sheer number of practitioners is increasing slowly.
Yes, do you see that?
I see that. It's hard. I'm still positive about the scene. Mm-hmm. I still think that a lot of the work will still have to be continued in the way it is now, quietly, underground. But I don't see it as some kind of a revolution that's going to change things overnight. Mm-hmm. But I think the biggest job really is to find for a public consciousness the reason for contemporary dance to exist. And that, because of the nature of the practice here, no, it comes from very individual standpoints. It's not like a whole history of post-World War II, needing to do away with a certain classicism. It's not that, because everywhere else, the way modernity developed, our modernity is what is Bharatanatyam and other dances today. That is the modern of this country, actually. It's not. So then, when you have this, and when you have a reluctance of accepting that, how can you approach the contemporary? How do you define it? How do you evaluate the need for it and its place? So I would be keen for us to be a little bit more critical, not in boxing things or labeling things too quickly, but in being able to understand process and thinking around the making of works. And I think that is where sustenance will come from. You know, every time we finished performing the Jumping Project, I would always pick up the mic to introduce all the jumpers, because I found them so different, and you know, I felt the audience needed to know that so-and-so is an arts therapist and so-and-so is actually a lawyer battling cases in court, and you know, I was very proud of everybody, and so I would do that. And one of the questions was like, how do you all work? This is such a big group, and how do you work together, and who's your co-producer? So I will maintain that, not just for the Jumping Project, but also for all the work that I'm doing, the artists are the main funders.
Yes.
So a lot of the work, and I say it very consciously, because even in the project I'm engaged in right now, it has no big funding. Mm. We've been working for a year. I've had to fly in my dancers from wherever they are. They come and stay with me, and we find people's terraces, parks, streets to work in, sometimes the halls of institutions like the Allianz or the Goethe, to have a few rehearsals, short spans of time. And they're all kind in the way they do it, but it's more out of a personal knowing. It's not out of a certain channelized resource that you can systematically apply to and be supported by. This is purely a one-on-one personal relationship with individual directors or people who may be, you know, sympathetic or convinced of a certain project at a certain point in time. So it's not something you can always bank on. What you can bank on is, I hope it continues, the interest of dancers and movers in wanting to actually go beyond what there is. So that's largely how it goes, and how I do manage it is I try to allow some projects to pay for other projects. The making is usually the toughest part, because there's nothing there at that time, and I try to make the money back once the piece is made, which means that there is a certain responsibility in trying to make the piece stay alive for as long as possible, which is also an exhausting proposition. There are about two or three big contemporary dance festivals that are fairly recognized. There is the Art Gallery, there is the Gati's Festival Ignite, and these are the two main biannual ones. The Parks Festival is there. I did show some work with them, but it's also looking at a certain kind of work that is curated in a particular way. Not always easy to be part of that curation, so it's a good thing that's happening. The more number of festivals, the better. The more number of festivals, the better for general practitioners. But by and large, my work in Chennai over the last 5-6 years, I undertake to show it myself, because this is where I make the work. I feel a necessity to share it here first, and after that, I've never been able to show work here. After the initial showing, it's very hard to return to Chennai to show work. So festival networks are one in a few places.
International showing?
Yes, I've shown in London, I've shown in Vienna the Impulse Dance, and at the South Bank Centre in London, the Impulse Dance in Vienna. A few like this, but by and large, it's not really, it's always within a certain India interest that these, you know, there's a chapter of India interest happening, and therefore I've not really been able to discuss the meat of the work itself beyond its Indianness with a lot of international presenters. But having said that, we've had some good shows with a lot of good interest, people coming and talking and writing and blogging, and all of that has been very, very, these are the things that keep us going, actually. So that way, it's all right. But it's hard to foresee exactly where.
But, you know, you feel that you're...
No, I feel that it's very, very hard to exist in Chennai.
Still here.
I'm here because it's also a place that, for me, as a maker, apart from the fact that I struggle to find dancers here, I mean, it's a fact. All my dancers are not from Chennai. What does that tell you? I mean, it's... Chennai is a bit resistant to trying things out as a, you know, for regularity of practice and for process. There's a certain distrust, you know, in even linking yourself, let alone the practicalities of time and all of that, but there's a certain distrust of what the experience will do to you if you submit to it, kind of thing. So that's a problem. But on the other hand, there is a culture of work here which is very strong. Culture of rigor and practice, which is very strong, which I tap into. And as a maker, there are many other makers here from other fields whom I respect deeply, whom I can go and sit and chat and have a conversation with, which helps me think and breathe. So I choose to stay on in Chennai to work. And there are people like Sadhanand, or I've used spaces as a laboratory for my trials and making of work since 2007 till 2015. It's a long time. And so that way I feel that I'm in touch with people who, there are pockets, there are pockets of things that are possible in this city and a general environment. It's a good city for making work, I think. Well, the only important kind of a question remains for me, not that you've forgotten or anything of the sort, but it's just an added offering into the discussion, is the question of when you make work and when it's a contemporary work coming out of this country, the challenge is to see to what degree it remains specific and at the same time manages to have a hold on a larger viewership, which I think is important. Because the questions that art must ask cannot be bound by topicality of place and geography and culture and environment alone. It needs to transcend that. And this is something that I'm very conscious of, and my desire, deep desire, is to be making work that does not isolate the viewer, that allows most amount of people to feel able to actually enter the space.